love the series ever since it was released in 1996. And not gonna lie, for a series that had been made for children, this series packs a punch with a couple of its trainers. Okay, a lot of them. So, I decided to replay a lot of the Pokemon games. By the way, this is Generation 1 through 6, 7, 8, and 9 will be coming out another time. And I want to talk about the hard trainers that I encounter. Rules here are that the only gym leaders on this list are no more than 3 entries of Generation, and we're only going to Generation 6, as I mentioned before. If you don't know what Generation 6 is, it's the Kalos region. I'm currently playing Alola and Shield, so there will be rankings on those gym leaders in the future. Because, oh boy, I have a feeling my opinion is going to change by the time this video is posted. Also, this is in order of how difficult I personally found these battles. So if you have criticism, or you think there was a trainer that was way harder for you, and there probably is, because everyone's interpretation on difficulty is as different as ice cream flavors. So please be nice in the comments. Anyway, with that aside, let's get into this. This trainer is infamous for all the wrong reasons, my friends. Whitney in HeartGold is just one of many nightmares for these players. And if you ask me personally, I don't think she deserves this much attention. Whitney has only 2 Pokemon, Clefairy and Miltank, and she's the 3rd gym leader. Her Miltank was nothing to my goddamn Ariados in Gold. However, when I replayed the game in HeartGold SoulSilver, this Miltank must have had a thirst for revenge because it mopped the floor with a lot of my Pokemon. Its rollout will just about tank through anything and everything you throw at it if you don't deal with it fast enough. But the arguably most annoying part is that annoying-ass milk drink to heal itself. It almost feels like the game is cheating, because let's just point out these facts. Whitney is only the 3rd gym leader that you face. She's a normal-type gym, and she has a Pokemon that knows Rollout, which if you don't know, does this amount of damage, and her Miltank knows Milk Drink, which, oh my gosh, it's a nightmare setup from the beginning. Sure, there are counters to deal with this, but if you decide not to use them like I foolishly did, this Miltank will be a royal pain in the arse to deal with. Miltank isn't the only problem here. Whitney also has a Clefairy that knows Metronome, which means it can literally use any attack and it's a gamble. You get a super effective hit, you're basically screwed. So yeah, Whitney with the right Pokemon, she isn't too bad, but without them, you're gonna be in a lot of trouble. Trainer that made me realize that I was in a lot of trouble in my Let's Go Eevee Nuzlocke run. Sabrina is a psychic gym leader in the Kanto region. That spells a lot of trouble out because psychic's weakness in Gym 1 is ghost types, but the Ghastly family is also part poison type, giving Sabrina a rather huge opening. Plus, for some goofed up reason, the code didn't recognize or even register psychic type's weaknesses to ghost. Fuck. Sabrina has a Kadabra, Mr. Mime, Venomoth, and an Alakazam. Her Venomoth is no sweat, but Mr. Mime, Kadabra, and Alakazam are all insanely stupid hard hitters and have moves to boost up their poor defense. Plus, in Generation 1, Special Attack and Defense were all one stat called Special, and these 3 Pokemon have stupidly high Special stats, which means they hit hard with their Special moves, and can tank special moves really well. You basically must use physical moves and pray to God these damn Pokemon don't one-shot your Pokemon before you can start doing damage. Her nightmare Pokemon is easily her Alakazam, because that thing hits like a semi-truck and can spam recover and undo all your hard work. Now, to be fair, in Pokemon Yellow and Let's Go Pikachu / Eevee, she's a bit easier to deal with, minus the fact that her Alakazam is still her ace and can still do some decent damage. However, in Yellow, you might have a good chance of battling her with Pokemon that are way too low of a level, but if you do it right, everything should be okay. Before all you fans from the Sabrina Nation come and attack me for putting Sabrina this low, the reason why is because just the fucked up code. That's like an unfair advantage. from the Johto games. But want to know my controversial opinion? Claire was and always has been so much harder. Why does no one talk about her again? In every single playthrough of the Johto games that I've played, including the Remix Runaway, Claire has given me one heck of a run for my money. Number one problem, she's a dragon type leader who in gold / silver has three Dragonairs and a Kingdra. However, in HeartGold Soul Silver, she replaced one of the Dragonairs with a Gyarados. Which, to make things worse, she's got dragon types in a game that only has two dragon type evolution lines. Fine for her, hell for you, since you can't get a dragon type this easily in this game. Sure, there's ice types like Smoochum, Delibird, the Swinub evolution line, and Sneasel, which will be fine for her Dragonairs and HeartGold Soul Silver. There are plenty of electric types that should easily deal with her Gyarados. But those aren't the problem. This thing is! Her freaking Kingdra being a water / dragon type. This thing only has one weakness, dragon. And in this game, you can only get two dragon types, Horsey and the Whirl Islands for your own Kingdra and Dratini, which good luck finding one of those before you can even battle Claire. So there is almost no way in hell you can get a type advantage here. And not just that, this thing, depending on the generation you fight it, can combat with Surf, Hydro Pump, Dragon Breath, Dragon Pulse, or even a goddamn Hyper Beam, all of which can do a stupid amount of damage against every opponent it comes across. But that's not the end of it. Kingdra can also crank up the difficulty with the move Smokescreen, making it close to impossible to land a solid hit, letting this thing fucking destroy you while you can't land a single hit on it because you're over here trying to play Whack-A-Mole. Like, jeez Louise! Unlike Whitney, who has a way to counter the problems, there's almost no way to counter Claire here. You have to tank this out and hope to gosh you get lucky enough to kill this monster before it tanks your entire team. Not to discredit Whitney here, she's a spite compared to the other gym leaders, but with a counter, you're all good. Like I said before, with Claire, there is no counter. There is no easy way around this. You have to tank it out. Stupid Kingdra. To be honest, I have no idea if this is just a me problem, but Winona has been a problem to me since I played Pokemon Ruby. Winona has a Swillow, Malapur, Skarmory, and the infamous Altaria. Her Swallow isn't a problem, to be honest, neither is her Skarmory. Sure, Palafar can be a little annoying when Winona starts spamming Protect, but none of that compares to her big bad Altaria, who knows Dragon Dance, which, fun fact, actually, this thing shouldn't even know Dragon Dance. You don't usually get that shit until level 40. Winona's Altaria is level 33. Also, fun fact, this thing is so infamous, it gained the nickname Winona's Illegal Altaria. Anyway, Altaria knows Dragon Dance, which heavily boosts its power and speed, and Earthquake, which is not very good, especially if you're trying to use an Electric or Magneton to Thunderbolt, hoping to get a one-shot. This battle, like many of the Hoenn gym leaders, is not one to be messed with. It's just her illegal Altaria that makes me frustrated, especially when she eliminated my Nuzlocke. Still unforgiving you, Winona, for that one. I'm coming for you. Anyway, moving on. Originally, Tate and Liza were in this spot because, you know, double battle gym leaders, it was the first time ever. But to be honest, I entirely forgot about Lenora until I replayed the games for the video, and geez Louise, Lenora threw a huge wrench in the works, I swear. This gym leader can wipe the floor with just about anybody if you're not careful. The worst part about this is that Lenora is a normal type gym leader, and she's only the second gym leader in the game. Yeah, you're in quite a bit of trouble. The only counter options you have are Roggenrola, Pignite if you picked them, Timber, throw and sock. That's it. Lenora leads with a Herdier, which knows takedown, which can be a hell of an annoying move to deal with, but can also be a good thing if used too much. It'll just take itself out. Also, its ability is Intimidate, which can lower your attack power. So, here's the answer. You either just keep your fighting type away from Herdier, or use it later. Not the biggest problem, but this thing ain't a pushover either. She also has her ace, Watchhog, who knows Retaliate, which does 70 damage, but can be doubled to 140 if a teammate faints. Yeah, that's one hell of a problem. An even bigger problem is that this move cannot be resisted by any Pokemon except a wildly overpowered Excadrill or Roggenrola. Leering Crunch can lower your defense instead of Retaliate for a perfect knockout, and Hypnosis can straight up make your Pokemon fall asleep, and that can be an annoyance all on its own unless you brought a bunch of Awakenings. The only way I managed to get through Lenora was I started grinding like a madman with my Servine. However, if you don't want to do that, you're best off with a Sock or a Throw or a Timber for Lenora. Best of luck, soldiers. Gonna be 1000% honest here. The term looks are deceiving definitely applied to this gym leader when I first spot her. You better have brought a bit of patience if you're gonna wanna deal with Fantina. She leads with a Drifblim, who knows Ominous Wind, which does a good chunk of damage, and this thing gets a pretty annoying as hell stat boost. It also knows Minimize, which makes it annoying as hell to hit, Astonish, which has a chance to make your Pokemon flinch, and Gust, which if you're using grass types, you're in a bit of a pinch here. Then you also gotta deal with Gengar, who knows Confuse Ray, and Shadow Claw, along with Miss Magus, which if used properly can start racking up some pretty serious damage. Then Miss Magus comes out, and this thing knows Confuse Ray, Shadow Claw, Magical Leaf, and Psybeam, which if you don't know, is a very broad moveset, like holy crap! The best advice I have for y'all is get the move Bite on at least one of your Pokemon. I had Bite on my Luxray and I legit tanked through her Drifblim Miss Magus with that. Then swapped over to my Staraptor and demolished her Gengar. That is the only way I ended up getting through Fantina's gym. But yeah, basically, get your hands on a Staraptor or a Luxray and then you're all good. While I will address this really quickly, Fantina isn't the hardest in her arena, but she definitely did give me a run for my money back when I was a kid. Even now, I still have trouble taking her down. This is the third and final normal type gym leader on the list, I promise! Norman, the man of apes and gorillas, and Curious George himself. Oh boy, this man gave me one hell of a run for my money, and he still does. Also, fun fact, this fucker right here is the only gym leader to have a base stat total of fucking Groudon himself! To make shit worse, he's got two of them! Yeah, that's not too good. In Ruby and Sapphire, Norman has two Slakings! An insanely, stupidly powerful Pokemon with a base stat total of 670. What the fuck? Slaking's attacks are 160, and to make this worse, they also have 150 HP and 100 defense. Special defense is poor, but remember, this is Gen 3. Normal's only weakness is fighting type. All fighting type moves are physical! In other words, that doesn't mean jack, despite a special defense being, you know, garbage. The first Slaking has Yawn, but the other one can use Slack Off to heal even after Norman runs out of Hyper Potions, and if you misplay, look out! This Slaking has Focus Punch, which will abolish most of your team. Don't even think about burning, paralyzing, or poisoning these things either, because they have Facade, which doubles their normal 70 attack power to 140 if they have one of those statuses. Also, here comes the absolute worst part. Yes, we're getting to the worst part, finally. This is the gym after Flannery. Yet, his ace Pokemon is 3 levels higher. In other words, Norman is one hell of a man to fight. The Slaking's base stats are so damn high and incredibly rough. Especially since you will most likely not be prepared to face this gym unless you do some serious grinding. And I'm not talking 1 or 2 levels, I'm talking like 5 or 10. The only saving grace here is that Slaking has an ability called Truon. It attacks every other turn so you could just heal, stall, and win. Truon takes this fight from holy hell this is impossible to holy shit this is hard. Anyway, his Emerald team isn't nearly as bad as one of his Slakings is gone, replaced with a Spinda and a Linoon, which makes this much easier, but watch out for that damn Linoon because it has a move called Belly Drum. It will match up the attack, Hyper Potions from Norman, and a base speed stat of 100. Jeepers! I speak from experience of almost getting mopped by this thing. It was awful. Man, Karina and Grant fought for this spot, but Karina is easy to deal with if you have a psychic or flying type that's fast enough that you can outspeed her, and Grant can easily be swept if you have a strong enough war type. Valerie is ultimately the one who takes the cake. She's the first fairy trainer in the entire series, and honestly, she almost wiped my team and my dumbass thinking I could use dragon type moves. So that was a ruse hell wake up call. The fairy type was first introduced in the Kalos region, meaning you don't know a lot about it. Many of these Pokemon are actually cute as hell in appearance, but oh boy, that exterior hides some extremely strong battle potential, with statistically the highest special defense and full immunity to dragons. Fairy types can easily sweep the field. Valerie's team includes a mix of old and new Pokemon, a Mawile, a Mr. Mime, and her Sylveon. For Mawile's steel typing gave it some powerful defenses, while Mr. Mime could set up both Light Screen and Reflect before delivering a powerful psychic attack. Anyone not packing a poison type or steel type of their own was sure gonna have a hard time standing up against Valerie's team of fairy types. Not gonna lie though, her Sylveon is the real menace to society. The best way to take out her Mr. Mime is with poison. Mawile, you're gonna wanna use fire, and Sylveon, you're gonna want a ghost type. That's at least how I took her out. I've seen some lunatics take her out with a Charizard or other weaker Pokemon alone. But I personally like a challenge. And Valerie definitely gave younger me a run for my monies. Candace. Boy, oh boy, you are a nuisance, my friend. Poor little me to understand type weaknesses until I began writing them down. But man, that caused me to lose a lot to Candace's goddamn Froslass. But now I love that Pokemon because teamed with a Pokemon who has the ability Snow Warning will activate Snowcloak if it has it. And oh gods, watch out for that, by the way, because that is the main reason why Candace is this high. Because of the unfair stat play that makes this unbelievably hard. Candace's Sneasel and Pelosswine never really gave me that much of a problem, but her Abomasnow hits like a truck, and with its Snow Warning ability, Frostlass's ability of Snowcloak, and that thing is a deadly pair. Her Sneasel and her Pelosswine, like I said before, aren't that bad, and they can easily be handled. The real problem, though, is that deadly duo, and yeah, that Abomasnow hits like a truck, but there is one problem with Abomasnow itself, and I think this balances it out. Abomasnow is an ice grass type, making it take quad damage to fire types. So in other words, get a fire type move and Abomasnow is easy. Actually, get fire type for the whole gym. Frostlass is a little bit more difficult because, like I said before, it has Snowcloak, and it also knows Double Team, and it can easily become very difficult to hit. Again, my best advice, get your hands on a Fire-type and pray to Grush you'll get by without running out of power points for Fire-type moves. Other than that, good luck. gosh. Talk about trigger material. Elisa is a real piece of work, especially with her stupid Amolgas. Electricity has one weakness, ground. However, Elisa's Amolgas are part flying type, so the ground doesn't do jack squat to them, but they are weak to rock and ice type moves. However, being where you are in the game, this is the fourth gym by the way, ice type moves are very difficult to come by, which leaves rock type moves. Now, if these boys had like moves like Shockwave or Spark or literally anything else, this wouldn't be this high on the list. But no, her Amolgas and her Zebstrika know Volt Switch, which allows them to switch out and let another Amolga or Zebstrika tank the hit. For example, go for a rock move on Amolga, Volt Switch out, hit Zebstrika, who, by the way, is not very weak to rock. But then, you go for a ground type move on Zebstrika, switch out, Amolga comes in, no effect. Go for a rock type move, switch Zebstrika back in, not weak to rock. Yeah, this got kind of annoying very, very quickly. Every once in a while, I get lucky and hit another Amolga with a rock type move, but I swear, getting past this chaos is... oh my gosh! As if to add more pain on the cake of rage, her Amolgas have a stab move called Aerial Ace, which is nothing to sneeze at. This was the trainer in Black and White and possibly the entire series that gave me the most trouble and made me realize, okay, my Nuzlocke might end early. Fun fact, apparently Elisa gave a lot of people so much trouble, so badly to the point where she was nerfed in the sequel. One of her Amolgas was replaced with a much less threatening Flaffy and the other forgot Aerial Ace. Wow! Elisa posed such a problem that she was literally nerfed. That's kind of crazy to be honest. However, I always go back just to challenge myself because to be honest, despite it being utter bullcrap, it was still kind of fun in the end. Hello, welcome to the outro, and huge thank you to Raffy Arts for making the thumbnail to this video. Not gonna lie, this was one of those videos that made me mad when I was making it, because honestly, getting past Elisa in Black and White was just infuriating. Or, who knows, maybe I'm just bad. It's probably because I'm bad, but meh. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching to the end, and oh my gosh, thank you so much for over 150 subscribers. You guys are insane. You guys are amazing. Thanks so much for enjoying my content. And I hope I can continue to make you guys more amazing content. Anyway, see you. Bye-bye. See you in the next one.